Welcome to my brief status report on quantum gravity from causal dynamical triangulations. What you see here on the first slide is an illustration of how far we've come from the beginnings of this approach. The first interesting results in four dimensions of the emergence of an extended universe in 2004 to what we can do now, which is to actually determine a local curvature property of this emergent space-time with the help of a new notion of Ricci curvature. Let me give you an overview of what this talk will contain. So the essential thing is to, the basis is a research program of CDT that aims to construct a theory of quantum gravity and study its properties directly in a non-perturbative Planckian regime. What I will cover is some ingredients, philosophy, place in the larger scheme of gravity approaches, quantum gravity approaches, and structural properties of CDT. The motivation and expectations that were there at the outset, the status quo, and the results that have been achieved, how they relate to our actual universe, and what are the prospects of testing them or observationally verifying them. And finally, some future ambitions that relate to early universe physics. Now, I'm not assuming that you're familiar with CDT as an approach to quantum gravity. So let me illustrate some of the basics. We are talking about an implementation of the gravitational path integral, simply over metric degrees of freedom. So the metric G or equivalence classes of metrics. The approach is non-perturbative, so it doesn't rely on a split with the background, so there's no distinguished background either. It's in Lorentzian signature, it's in 4D, and it's not of the grand unified type, so it doesn't rely on the existence of a unified dynamical principle that also includes other matter fields. The embryonic idea was conceived in 1998, where we were searching to make the non-perturbative path integrals that existed at the time and were very Euclidean in nature, to make them Lorentzian and hopefully fix some of the issues one had with them. So there's a new idea that is CDT, what's called CDT now. It was first tackled in 2D, shown to be exactly soluble, and the result showed that really the signature of the path integral matters. So an interesting result. Now, coming back to 4D, to characterize kind of where is CDT in the larger universe, well, it combines geometric insights. So not relying on a perturbative split of G mu nu into Minkowski plus linear perturbation. So it really can describe, you know, strong gravity, strong quantum gravity regimes, but without relying on a 3+1 decomposition, but rather using the beauty really of 4D covariance of the path integral. The carrier space, the configuration space of the path integral is a regularized version of the space of geometries, by which I mean the space of equivalence classes of Lorentzian metrics modulo the action of the four-dimensional diffeomorphism group, classically. Now, these are piecewise flat, simplicial manifolds, T, and simplicial means made from simplices, and simplices are higher four-dimensional generalizations of triangles. So here is a building block of the type, the four simplex of the type we use in CDT, and from which we assemble four-dimensional curved piecewise flat space-times. The ingredients here are rather minimalistic and not and conservative, you could say. We are just relying on the degrees of freedom of classical GR and its diffeomorphism symmetry, and use only standard quantum field theory, nothing that goes over the standard concepts of quantum theory. However, when one adapts these latter methods to dynamical geometry and invents methods that numerically enable one to really study the non-perturbative regimes, that is enough to find very interesting and completely unexpected results. So without exotic ingredients on the Planck scale. Now, as I mentioned in passing already, CDT resolves problems associated with Euclidean path integrals, and some of these will come back. The general philosophy, putting quantum gravity on the lattice, is that the lattice should act as a regulator with the ultraviolet short distance cutoff A, kind of the edge length, essentially. And one then searches for a continuum limit by approaching a second order phase transition in the space, in the coupling constant space, bare coupling constants of the theory, in the limit as A goes to zero, while renormalizing bare couplings in an appropriate manner. If all goes well, one in this way attains a continuum theory that is universal, so is independent of details of the regularization one has put in, and also is kind of essentially unique in the sense that you only need to fine-tune, you know, a small number of coupling constants. Let me warn you that this is not discrete quantum gravity in two senses. The geometries that go into the Smithian manifold, they're continuous objects. They are non-smooth, but they are continuous. So they're not discrete bits. And also no assumption of fundamental discreteness is used anywhere in this approach. So it's really the discreteness or the scales that appear here are regulators that are taken away in the end. So it reaches where other methods don't by the availability of, well, first a very concrete formalism and one that is amenable to numerical methods, Monte Carlo simulations in the first place in four dimensions. And obviously as such, it is subject to numerical limitations, like also, you know, lattice QCD is. I would divide lattice approaches to quantum gravity into two categories, broadly speaking, a naive one, where one puts GR in a first order formulation, so using tetrads and spin connections to make it look like a gauge theory on a fixed, typically hypercubic lattice. Now, this has been practiced since the late 70s and was very popular for a while. The problem really is that the diffeomorphism symmetry is very badly broken in this type of approach. And so far one hasn't seen interesting results coming out from this type of approach. There is a not so naive lattice, a quantum gravity, which originated roughly at the same time. It is based on what you may know as ratchet calculus, the idea to describe classically already GR without coordinates. Due to Regge from 1961. And so classically one substitutes a manifold plus G mu nu by, you could say, discretized data of a triangulation, and where you have to give me how you glue your triangular building blocks together and what the edge lengths of all the edges are, and that uniquely fixes the geometry. You re-express the gravitational action as a function of these variables. And that's an idea you can also use in the path integral. The real beauty and what makes really crucially contributes to the success of this type of formulation is that one works directly on the space of geometries of a regularized version of that space. And moreover, in CDT, one again makes a special choice where basically one only has two types of edge lengths, a time and space-like edge, and then sums over all ways in which a number of very simple the building blocks can be glued together. The whole thing is diffeomorphism invariant, manifestly. Diffeomorphisms don't act. There is a kind of a weak equivalent, a notion of labeling invariants that is accounted for exactly in treatments of DT and also CDT. Now, what is a path integral? And now, what does it become in this approach? Here on the left is this formal continuum expression one writes down. Now in CDT, this becomes continuum limit of a sum over inequivalent triangulations T, which carry a causal structure with a simple measure factor and just the Regge version of the exponential of e to the is, the gravitational action. Now, a quick lineup of interesting comments on this object. One can, of course, usually not evaluate or discuss convergence of these complex amplitude integrals or sums. and is then forced to do a Euclidean path integral instead, where the I is missing, everything is real, but one doesn't really know how these two things are related to each other beyond perturbation theory. Now, by contrast, in CDT, there is a well-defined analytic continuation, which we apply to the complex path integral and map it to a well in a well-defined way to a Euclidean object, and where we then do the computations. Now, it's usually difficult in non-perturbative path integrals to implement the diffeomorphism symmetry and in such a way that it's compatible, or rather to set up the renormalization regularization in a way that is compatible with that symmetry. That is, again, not an issue in CDT. It has no residual symmetries, and it has a geometric cutoff, this UV cutoff A I mentioned earlier. Divergences are, of course, all over the place when you do quantum field theoretic path integrals. Especially careful you have to be when you do some kind of discrete approach, that you don't include too many degrees of freedom, because then you run into potential problems that the divergence is so big that it cannot be really accommodated with standard renormalization method. That doesn't seem to be the case, and there's good evidence in CDT that the number of configurations as a function of the volume is exponentially bounded, the number of states. Now, how do we do the integral in the first place? These are no Gaussians, even after we, you know, remove the I, get rid of the I. Again, what helps us is the completely different way in which these degrees of freedom are described in CDT, and then the fact that the approach is amenable to Markov chain Monte Carlo simulations to get quantitative results out and act as reality checks on what the theory tells us. Now, lastly, interesting point in passing, and an issue that's sometimes not even discussed very much, unitarity. So here, CDT has been shown to be reflection positive with respect to the kind of discrete proper time variable that is in the setup. And therefore, if a continuum theory exists, you can be almost assured that it's unitary. So that's a nice property. Now, moving back to results and physics and the questions we've been asked to address, the main motivation and the expectation at the outset was kind of a technical one, namely, as it's often in quantum gravity, to try and improve on another approach that has run into difficulties. And in our case, it was the Euclidean path integral that really had run into difficulties showing in the same type of lattice approach, showing that there is a good classical limit, showing that there are second order transition, and apparently instabilities kind of an entropic nature, which seemed to be very generic in the path integral in general, contributed to those problems being there. Then the conjecture was maybe implementing a causal structure by hand at the micro level, at the level of the fundamental building blocks and the gluing rules, could cure this type of pathology. Now, more physically speaking, the question was, can by this entirely quantum field theoretic construction, can we find evidence for the existence of a continuum theory of quantum gravity as a suitable scaling limit of CDT, analogous to what can show to happen in 2D, but of course 4D is a different and much more complicated matter. One, in addition, is interested, of course, in physical properties of the model of the theory. One hopes to be able to develop sufficiently quantitative computational methods to measure suitable non-perturbative quantum observables overhead, evaluating them on the ensemble to, number one, understand the nature and behavior of quantum space-time near the Planck scale, and perhaps understand true degrees of freedom that govern the dynamics there. Secondly, find evidence of the existence of a classical limit, which is, of course, needed really to, as one of the boundary conditions of such an approach, to reproduce results from GR on suitably long scales. This is very non-trivial for non-perturbative approaches that kind of got rid of G mu nu at the start to reproduce those. And of course, to find a quantum signature, hopefully, that might then lead to new physical predictions. Which of these expectations have been met? With respect to introducing a microstructure, still the way it's done in CDT remains the only known cure against the dominance of these, what I called entropic instabilities of the non-perturbative path integral, which makes it typically degenerate into ensembles of branched polymers or similar things which have nothing to do with extended four-dimensional space-time. So that's certainly an expectation that has been met, showing that there is a unique continuum theory behind the construction has not been shown, strictly speaking, but some preconditions to that have been exhibited. The phase space of CDT has been shown to contain several second order transition lines, which are all candidates for possible scaling limits. It has been shown that Wilsonian renormalization group methods are applicable, despite the fact that there is no fixed background metric. But the results, there are no conclusive results on the nature of the renormalization group flows one can construct by using this technology. That has to do with the fact, number one, that it's difficult, really technically difficult, to measure with sufficient accuracy near the second order phase transitions. Secondly, we do not have a sufficiently big set of reliable observables, which would help us to pin down what we call trajectories of constant physics along which these flows should then take place. And this then also means we are not yet able to verify what we are believing we are able in principle to do, that asymptotic safety is realized, namely that there is a fixed point of the RG flow in the ultraviolet, as is postulated in asymptotic safety. Now, so we've come away, although we haven't shown that there is, we obtain a unique continuum theory, it's clear already that the formalism of CDT gives us a reliable non-perturbative computational framework to make computation within about an order of magnitude of the Planck scale. And the evidence is, for instance, the quantum effect of the spectral dimension that has not been only in our approach, has been not measured just in CDT, but also by other approaches, and that finds this interesting dimensional reduction phenomenon. So that comes straight from a CDT computation, and that's where it was first found. Secondly, for instance, we can, close to the Planck scale, we try and understand the dynamics of the fluctuations of the Friedmann scale factor. And we can map this beautifully to a mini superspace treatment. Yeah? So that gives us great confidence in the computational viability of this approach, and allows us to really understand Planckian dynamics. Now, as for observables of new effect, well, there is just the one, the Planckian dimensional reduction that gives us perhaps an insight into the nature of quantum geometry on very short scales. Now, so this reduction I already mentioned, perhaps is a hint of fractality. Now, where we do have lots of interesting results is in terms of evidence for the emergence of a good classic limit of a classical spacetime in this case. And let me just flash a few graphs, both to give you an idea of the nature of the kind of computer experiments we do, the results that come out. Yeah, here we have determined by simulations the spectral dimension of the universe you see here. And you see here that it's dynamical, and this is Planckian scales. It smoothly changes from large to small values. The fact that the dynamically generated universe in the de Sitter phase of CDT has, that's why it's called that, has a beautiful de Sitter shape matching to the classical solution with positive cosmological constant of general relativity. Here are the volume fluctuations I have already talked about. It's one of the low-lying modes. And these are the recent results where we match the average curvature of this generated, this dynamically generated space-time with those of a classical de Sitter, and also find nice coincidence. Now, that brings me to the next point. So how do these results relate to our actual universe? So the question we were actually asked by the organizers is to explain like how everything is just contained in our approach. But this is not exactly the question that's applicable to CDT, quantum gravity, because it's not a unified theory. But of course, its primary aim is to construct in the first place a quantum gravitational theory, assuming that this is non-trivial, and then determine at what scales and how it interacts with matter. And that is easily done in principle by simply adding, you know, in under the integral to the sum of all geometries, then for each of these geometries, a full kind of matter pass into in this way. And this has been done, and it can easily be done in CDT. Now, the findings we have on the classical limit cannot be called predictions. You could say they're postdictions. They're at least compatible with properties of our own universe. So number one, CDT predicts, postdicts a universe that has positive cosmological constant and which on large scales is extended and four-dimensional or coinciding with properties of our current universe, and whose shape and average curvature are again compatible with those of a de Sitter space, as I have already mentioned. And that's, of course, also the de Sitter space is just the model that is being used to understand and describe the very early universe. Now, the bonus in our way, in CDT's way of describing, is that these properties are being derived from first principles in a full quantum theory and doesn't and don't rely on any symmetry reduction like one would perform in cosmology. So in principle, one has access to a whole variety of diffeomorphism invariant observables, including correlation functions, two-point functions, or higher order correlation functions. Now, towards testability. Now, I singled out the single result that one could call a genuine quantum gravitational signature that's predicted by CDT and now also by other theories. And it's exactly this dynamical reduction of the spectral dimension of spacetime to two in the vicinity of the Planck scale. We don't really know how to relate that to true physical phenomenology. What would be required to do this would be a better understanding of the interaction of gravity and matter, depending on the scale, and also an argument that there are, you know, astrophysical effects where the tiny, of course, the tiny effects that are there are suitably enhanced, yeah, or magnified. There has been, I mean, people are starting to think about this, which is extremely welcome and exciting. So there have been first attempts to construct effective models of the influence of a scale-dependent space-time dimension microscopically on gravitational wave propagation. As I said, these are very interesting developments. Here one should maybe add a note of caution, namely that the dimension of a space provides, of course, a very incomplete characterization of it. I mean, many non-canonical, non-classical dimensionalities are related to totally different kind of microscopic properties. So we do definitely need more information about quantum space-time in order to understand this phenomenon and possible phenomenology better. We have investigated CDT and matter couplings. There is more to be said, but very briefly, we haven't seen a very significant impact of the way we have maybe naively coupled matter to the geometry on Planckian scales. it's too early to draw a grand conclusion. More things need to be understood. The relation Lorentzian-Euclidean needs to be understood better. But of course, a possible interpretation might be that there is not very much impact on the geometry of matter. So that matter doesn't actually matter so much at the Planck scale. Now, that brings me to my last point. So future ambition and prospects. CDT is in the fortunate position to have a well-defined non-perturbative calculation framework that can produce numbers. That means expectation values of well-chosen quantum observables without relying on ad hoc assumptions. Of course, the art is to identify observables that can be reliably measured in the distant window that's available to us in the computer simulations while yielding interesting physical results. I'm particularly excited by a new observable based on the quantum Ricci curvature that opens new avenues towards relation, in particular with early universe physics. So having this Ricci curvature would help us to understand, for instance, the effect of a massive particle inserted in our kind of Euclideanized simulations, compare them with semi-classical expectation, maybe learn something about the Lorentzian Euclidean relations, to examine a very interesting singularity that we have seen to form in one of the phases of CDT, so not the de Sitter space phase, but the so-called bifurcation phase. Might this be a possible candidate of, you know, purely quantum gravitational structure formation? We can use the quantum Ricci curvature by virtue of its being actually not just a scalar, but a direction-dependent quantity for constructing space-time quantitative measures of space-time homogeneity and specifically isotropy, which is interesting and important when comparing with cosmology. And then again, another and clearly also technically challenging project would be to compute two-point functions on the Sitter space and compare those two what one can compute in the framework of QFT on the Sitter space in early universe investigations. And with this, I thank you very much for your attention, and I hope you'll have a good discussion.